Who here would be out on Halloween night? Just a show of hands if you'd be walking around. Now, I'd like you all to close your eyes and really think, why would you be out on Halloween night? How many of you would be out there because of the enticing promise of candy and sugar? How many of you would be out there to spend time with your friends? And how many of you would be out there for the costumes? Awesome. For as long as I can remember, I've loved Halloween. Yes, sure, the candy is great, but the real reason I'm out there? It's the costumes. I think of Halloween as a free Comic Con. There are costumes and food, and you can taste the electric buzz of excitement in the air. You can be anyone you want. I get that it's for kids nowadays, so there aren't usually a lot of in-depth costumes, but sometimes I see adults wandering around or handing out candy decked out in their full garb. I've seen some amazing glowing jellyfish costumes, Dumbledore's and Professor Trelawney's from the house that does Harry Potter themes every year, and many other stunning costumes. It's been my love of costumes and awesome clothing that has really fueled this project. Hi, my name is Hannah Florendo, and welcome to my Masterworks, Stitching the Story, a process of creating and designing a costume. Costumes for theater and performances have been used for centuries, since a Greek poet named Thespis began to use expressive clothing in his work to more effectively convey a character, setting, or a role a character might play in the 6th century BCE. He is recognized as the first actor and is considered one of the fathers of theater from history as we know it. In the 5th century BCE, Aeschylus, a Greek playwright, began using costumes for the performances of his tragedies to convey more emotion and the role, station, as well as the personality of a character. During the Middle Ages and Renaissance, costumes and set pieces began to grow in popularity as they helped capture a mood, create a more visually stimulating production, and entertain the audience better. During the 16th century, certain traveling theater troupes performed a style of theater called commedia dell'arte. In this style of theater, costumes represented stock characters such as the serving girl, doctor, or harlequin, which would represent an idea or category of character. The audience would then know the character's role and what the character stands for by their clothing. Then, between the 1770s and the 1870s, playwrights, directors, and entertainers began to have a greater desire for more accurate costumes that were personalized for a specific character in a specific play. As stage performances and traveling theater troupes became more popular, and people were growing more familiar with the different costumes from around the world, they wanted their performances to reflect the different kinds of dress as well as the large range in styles. After the 19th century, costume design began to be regarded as an increasingly specialized art, with two main ideas influencing it. The first one, historical accuracy, was used to capture the sense of a time period or a specific place around the world. The second idea was concept-driven costumes, where a costume designer used their imagination to produce works of art that captured a vision that may or may not have ties to a historical time or place. My costume fits more into the second, where although it has been inspired by tuxedos and Elizabethan century doublets, it has fantastical elements as well. My character, Ketchin, was created one sunny afternoon a couple summers ago when my best friend and I were trying to brainstorm new Dungeons & Dragons characters. We were playing around with the idea of a 3-foot-tall birdman who, dressed in really fancy clothing, wore boots over his bird feet, cast spells, and fought with a twig, and only knew a couple sentences total due to his complete lack of intelligence. And thus, Ketchin, the Transylvanian bird assassin, was born. These are drawings of Ketchin after he was turned back into a human, because I haven't really drawn him in his bird form. Ketchin's wardrobe was inspired by a couple of things. First of all, I'm absolutely obsessed with historical fashion, especially the Elizabethan doublets for men. I knew I wanted Ketchin to have an overly fancy and embellished wardrobe for a tiny 3-foot bird, so that's where I started. The colors for his outfits came from his connection to Dracula. He wears a lot of red, as the Court of Vampires does. The three main shades of red in Ketchin's costume are blood red, crimson, and scarlet, with gold embellishments on some of his clothes. I also really love the tails on tuxedo jackets, so he has this sort of flowy robe-like extension of his doublet as well. The costume I've created is a mixture of a couple of his outfits. It has the shape of his standard red checked doubleto, and his wings came from when he was transformed back into a human. You'll use this word a lot. It's a word I made up because it fits my costume best, as it is a mix of doublet and tuxedo. I've been referencing all these complicated pieces of Ketchen's past, so here's a brief backstory. Ketchen's story revolves around a lot of grief and pain. He was a high-ranking sorcerer warrior who worked for Dracula as an assassin, but he was secretly in love and married. When Dracula found out about his wife and son, because it was against the rules for his warrior to have a family, he burned Ketchen's wife Gladys at the stake and tried to transform Ketchen into a raven. Ketchen blocked Dracula's magic with a counterspell that sputtered and partially failed, resulting in his half-bird, half-man form. Ketchen then turned and fled, and for 20 years stayed as a Kenku before joining a group of traveling mercenaries with Sammy, the fire elemental druid, and Lily, the pink candy tiefling paladin. He traveled with them for a few years, adventuring in the Fey wilds and across all sorts of different planes until they found Dracula's newest hideout. They went in and killed the vampire count, and with that, Ketchen's curse was reversed, turning him back into a human and leaving him with a pair of black raven wings and a feather tattoo on his right hand. I talked to my original advisors, Liz Nankin and Inez Ortner, about how I wanted this costume to portray my character, Ketchen. First of all, I wanted Ketchen's costume to present masculine. Even though I was making it for myself, I didn't want to emphasize my more feminine qualities. That meant I needed to figure out how I was going to do this, knowing I wanted it to be more skin tight and not a baggy fit. Was I going to add padding so it neutralized the bust and curves that are usually seen as more feminine? Was I going to not care about how tight it was and maybe make it a bit baggier? I wasn't sure yet. Another thing I had to do was figure out how I was going to get in and out of it. I hadn't bought stretchy enough fabric to just have it be a sort of pullover type thing, so my advisors and I decided on using a zipper, hidden under a flap of fabric and held shut with metal frogs. These are metal frogs. They are not actual frogs, they're a sort of clasp. Originally, I'd intended it to be the blood red and checkered, crimson and blood red checkered design on the fabric, trying to make Ketchen's more standard day-to-day doubleto. Unfortunately, when I went to purchase fabric, I couldn't find it anywhere. What I did find at Roku's Saris and Fabrics, though, was the perfect fabric for Ketchen's wedding suit, and I thought that would be a nice way to bring some more meaning into the costume. The thing with not knowing how to sew and attempting to make a good garment as your first project is that you'll probably get something wrong. So, to give myself lots of time to practice, I began sewing around the end of November. In some of the sewing videos I'd been watching for research purposes only, I had seen these satchels and I wanted to try making some. The first bag I made was extremely simple. Denim belt for a strap, two layers of white cotton for the actual bag, and a reinforced pocket on the front. Here, I learned how to sew pockets, I learned how to hem, and how to attach a strap in the most secure way, a box or two lines with an X sewn inside. I also put pockets on the inside by sewing a rectangle of fabric to the inside layer and sewing lines up and down it to create pockets that were all in a line. The next one I made was made of many small scraps of fabric. Here I practiced sewing curves, attaching gold braid, attaching buttons, and layering all the pockets so I could all fit them on the bag, but open them all the way and use them to their maximum capacity. I put more inner pockets in this one, using the same technique as the last one. During the making of this bag, I came across a couple challenges, which ended up with me breaking a few sewing machine needles and learning that if you thread the machine wrong, your sewing machine will be very unhappy with you.
Here are the two bags I made. This is the first one. You can wear it like this, or like this, and it can fit a binder and a bunch of other stuff. This is the second one I made. As you can see, there's a lot of pockets on the front, pins, there's pockets on the inside, and it has two straps instead of just one.
I decided to try and make a garment so that my Masterworks project wouldn't be the first piece of clothing I'd sewn, because there's a very big difference between a bag and a costume. I decided to make a Starry Night dress that was inspired by these floaty garden dresses I'd seen watching sewing videos. Here's me cutting fabric for the overskirt. It was a circle skirt, so it would spin and twirl really nicely, as well as the fabric for the petticoats underneath. I sewed everything for this project on my mom's trusty old sewing machine. It's one of those really sturdy industrial metal ones that she was given secondhand when she was around 13, and it has somehow survived to this day. This is when we'd finished putting together each layer of the skirt and were about to begin working on the bodice. Here, I was cutting out bodice pieces. We changed a lot of the original pattern because I wanted the neckline to not be so low, and we dropped the empire waistline because I didn't like how high it was. These are an example of empire waistlines. This is a frame from the series Bridgerton, which is actually what the bodice pattern was from. See here, I was using white stretch cotton to make a mock-up of the bodice. Mock-ups are where you take the pattern and you cut it out of a different fabric than the one you are intending to make the garment out of, so that if it doesn't fit or if you need to edit it, you don't end up with a shredded piece of what was once fabric at the end. Because they are often made of pretty cheap fabric, they mean you don't need to spend a lot of money wasting material for the final garment. Here I was seam ripping darts to let out the final dress because it was still a little too small. This is a seam ripper. It's a small tool with a blade between two guidance spikes that help you get it into the seams and rip the small threads that hold the garment together. The next thing we did was baste the dress together. Basting is when you hand sew large stitches onto your project to hold the fabric together. Pins are spiky and tend to take up a lot of space, so sometimes it's easier to just do a basting stitch and then do all the final stitches on your machine. This is an example of a running stitch. It is easy and common, so it's usually used for basting. And here's the final dress. These were pictures taken by the fantastic Cole Winnie. Yes, where did I get to? La 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 la. All right. After making my dress, I jumped into making my final costume right away. Here's the process it took to create my doublet. We began with a printed pattern from Reconstructing History, which is a website that puts together patterns from different time periods throughout history so you can recreate them. Anyway, I printed off a pattern for a doublet, but we ended up changing and altering it so much, it basically ended up making our own pattern from scratch. Here, you can see me working on the pattern pieces. This was actually the majority of the project, as we made custom tails and added those, shortened and rounded the collar, changed the shape and placement of the armholes, added slits for the wings, harness, made our own custom sleeves, and made many more smaller edits. Here's a quote from my external advisor. We'd been struggling with the pattern and getting it to all fit together right, and Liz began talking about the what-ifs in the design process. It was really inspiring, and it helped me get back on my feet. The quote, "Design is all about making things beautiful, but most of design is thinking about the what-ifs." Here's the mock-up for my first doubleto. The mock-ups for the doubleto were made of two layers of soft pink denim with a white cotton for the parts of the costume that were going to be made out of yellow satin. At this point, the tails were still one piece, and we ended up changing this later so they would have better movement and wouldn't be so baggy. While I was working with Liz, I also got to try on a lot of tuxedo jackets so we could figure out how the tails were going to hang and what other elements we wanted to include in the doubleto.
This is the mock-up. I took the sleeves off, but it fits like this. Ta-da! As you can see, it's all held together very roughly because we had to make a bunch of edits after the fact, so yeah. We worked on the mock-up and messed around with adjusting the pattern more. We moved on to working with the final fabric. Here's a few pictures of me while I was cutting out the final pieces. I used a roller cutter for fabric, which is basically a pizza cutter. Here is the nearly done doublet. All we had left to do was finish the sleeves and the final touches, like the frogs and the hook and eye clasps, and the other side of the zipper.
See in the second picture how one of the tuxedo tails is curling and the other one is hanging straight? Curling and straight, yes. Very good. Anyway. Well, that's because we sewed these little leaf lines onto the tails to hold the lining to the brocade and then drop fishing weights down into the tips. Now is probably a good time to mention that I have a skin sensitivity, so all the elements of this doubleto had to be lined with soft, lightweight fabric, and all the seams had to be facing between the lining and the brocade. This means there are many different pieces of fabrics used throughout this costume because there's all the brocade, the satin, the lining, and something called interfacing, which is basically stiffer fabric with a heat-activating glue in it, so when you iron it, it sticks all the pieces of the fabric together. In each sleeve alone, there's 21 pieces of fabric. Here I am, hand sewing the frog clasps on. Yeah. Took a while. Here is the first ever costume I made of Ketchin, completely assembled from things I had in my house. And here's the final one. The price gap between the two of these is about $2 for the belt and about $500 for all the final materials. Yeah, it's not cheap. Here's the process I took to create my wings. Please keep in mind this is happening at the same time as the doublet. I began the process of creating my wings by creating a frame. My dad and I went to the Boeing Building Center and bought 20 feet of PVC piping. Then we used a heat gun to melt the PVC piping until it was flexible and we could bend it into the wing shape I wanted, based on real-life bird wings from the helpful book Sibley's Birding Basics. We then used a piece of Sintra board, which is basically PVC piping but in a flat sheet, to make the back plate by putting it in the oven until it was wiggly, and then we pressed it to my back and held it there so it could cool into the shape of my back. Here are the final frames when they are closed. See these big chunky metal things? Those are linear actuators, and they are what make the wings go up and down. They use batteries to help them create push and pull movements, and because I put gate hinges on the underside of the frame tops at like this little point way up here, see there's the hinge. They make the wings go up and down. There's also a switch which works because the wires from the battery pack attach on one side, the linear actuators attach to the middle connectors, and there are two small pieces of wire that connect the battery pack side to the connectors on the other side, but they cross in the middle. This cross causes the switch to, when flipped to the side with the crossed wires, reverse the original command of going up so they go down. Here are the final frames when they were open. Yes, they're very big. Like I said, I wanted my wings to have a lot of anatomical accuracy, so I used a few resources to make sure they looked like actual bird wings. I used Sibley's Birding Basics a lot, but I also used the trusty internet to give me access to helpful images like this, so I could make sure the feathers and frames really matched. As you can see here, the primary feathers are pointier and slightly thinner than the secondary feathers. Also, see this vein right here? This is farther towards the leading edge on the primary feathers and in the middle on the secondaries. I spent a lot of time looking at images like this and comparing two main categories of feathers to make sure I got all the details right. Here, I was making the main feathers. They consisted of a black cotton inner layer and a crushed velvet or shimmer fabric outer layer, which were glued together with a piece of wire between them to help them be stiff and hold their shape. Here are the finished feathers laid out on the frames of the wings. In the upper right-hand corner, you can see the paper cutouts I made originally as a pattern for the feathers, and here in the main photo are the finished ones. I began putting on the overlayer of feathers. These were dyed or spray-painted black feathers you can get at craft stores like Michael's. You can see that I've sewn all the main feathers together with a black yarn. This ensures that when the wings rise and fall, all the feathers go where they're supposed to and they don't get bent. I also put a black cotton cover over the frame to further hide it and ensure I had somewhere to glue the smaller feathers onto. This 10-month project has taught me all sorts of things. I've learned all these new skills, including how to use a sewing machine, how to create a pattern, edit a pattern, construct a garment, and I've been inspired to do a couple different things with my life. Firstly, it's inspired me to take textiles as one of my electives next year to further my understanding and learning of creating garments and working with fabrics. Surprisingly, I can't wait to get back behind my sewing machine, or my mom's sewing machine, to continue making clothes. I've already started planning my next projects, much to the chagrin and distress of my parents. Secondly, it's inspired me to consider pursuing costume design and costume creation for movies and theater as a career. I've been interested in following acting as a career since I watched The Hobbit, The Lord of the Rings, Pirates of the Caribbean, and the Marvel movies in grades 6 and 7. The characters and their costumes are all so vibrant and full of life, and I wanted to create something like that. I wanted to be something like that. And if I don't end up following my dreams as an actor, costume design and costume creation still gives me a chance to bring to life all these characters that need to be seen. I was interested in costume design and costume construction for Masterworks because I love to create costumes for characters I've developed in Dungeons and Dragons, among other things. I decided to start with Ketchin because currently he's one of my favorites as I relate to him a lot. My process of building my costume went as planned, although I did have a few very minor setbacks. The main challenges were probably editing the pattern so it actually fit me properly, and figuring out how the various fabrics behave differently from each other. Transferring the pattern from paper to cloth was also filled with challenges. The number of times you have to bring it back to the drawing board and change it and adapt it so it fits and has the right movement and flow was really the majority of the project. Working with textiles takes a lot of practice and patience and being prepared to fail. Adrian likes to tell us all the time in art that it's okay to fail, and it's actually a good thing because then you can see where you went wrong and what you can do to make it better, and it's true. If I'd done my project perfectly the first time, I wouldn't have learned half the things I did, and I definitely would have been less inspired to pursue costume design. If I did this project again, I can't really think of anything I'd want to change because every moment, every step of the way was valuable. This journey has been filled with amazing learning experiences, and I'm really glad I chose to walk this road. Thank you.
Takes over, blood is running, heart is pumping, as the battle gets closer. They can say what they want now, cause we'll be screaming out. We can be heroes everywhere we go, we can have all that we ever want.
There have been so many people that have helped me create these costumes, and I would like to take a little time to acknowledge their efforts, patience, and the kindnesses they have shown as I learned and grew throughout this project. Firstly, thank you so much to my amazing advisors. Liz, you put so much work and dedication throughout spring break and during this project, I owe you so much. You were constantly meeting with me, offering me advice, and guiding me through the steps it takes to be amazing and make amazing garments. Thank you for the last minute phone calls, supportive monologues, and all the little things you brought back from LA. This costume and I would not be where we are today without you. Adrian, thank you for putting up with my nonsense. You have been so patient and supportive, and you made sure that I was very aware from the beginning that five costumes like this may be a little too much. You have been so supportive, always offering helpful, constructive criticism and advice throughout this journey. You've been so inspiring from the first day in grade six until now, and the last few days of grade nine. You've shared stories, songs, and jokes, and you've always had something positive to say. Thank you for being someone I could always rely on for support and it being such a fun and awesome teacher. Secondly, thank you to my parents who've been a critical element of my project. Mom, thank you for spending hours helping me figure out how to do my doublet. And Dad, thank you for helping me with the frames for my wings. I love you both so much, and I'm so grateful for your continued support and guidance. Thirdly, I'd like to thank my amazing friends for always supporting me. Cole Winnie and Into the Horizon Productions, thank you for taking your camera out and helping me get all these amazing shots for my dress and doubleto. Noam, thank you for helping me put together the amazing video and getting the perfect shots to display my doubleto on film. To my best friend, Claire, thank you so much for being my inspiration and helping me brainstorm Kitchen originally. Your dedication and creativity, along with the random phone calls after school, have really helped keep me going the last few months. Inez, thank you for meeting with me originally for pattern planning and teaching me all these skills about measurements and fitting. Acceleration, wherever you are out there on YouTube, thank you for making those DIY videos for the wings that I based mine off of. You've responded to all my emails and have always been willing to offer support. Jen Henriksen, thank you for all the work you do to keep us unruly students on track and in the moment. Your encouragement, stern comments, and endless caramels have been so greatly appreciated by me and all my class. I know none of us would be where we are today without you. And lastly, thank you all so much for coming to my Masterworks presentation.
Have question period. Hannah will be addressed as Mix Florendo. So Mix Florendo, please. And we'll have first questions from advisors.
Oh dear. Okay.
Well, I have to honestly say thank you, Mix Florendo. You have answered all my questions. I have a lot of them written down. And your articulation, how you used your creativity, your inspiration, and your knowledge is complete. I want to thank you, for I was your advisor, but you taught me. I'm a different person. I think differently. And together, we figured out together how to understand when things don't go right, how to look at it differently. And every time I spoke with you, and every time you walked through the door, you had joy, commitment, and a resiliency to making this project through, and I want to thank you.
Here come the hard ones.
It's Florendo, that was amazing. It's been a privilege to be your teacher for 4 years and watch you just excel in all forms of art, especially those where you get to show your creativity, which is boundless. It's totally amazing.
Thank you.
My questions are much more teacherish. However, there's two things that I wanted to touch on. One, I guess, we'll start with the easier one, maybe. You said this was $500 just for the fabric. It was hours of work. We know about fast fashion. We know about the impacts on the climate of all this lovely clothing and us having a fashion sense as opposed to just wearing the same thing all the time. Why not just design our clothes online and have avatars instead of real costumes?
Well, the point of costumes is really to entertain and to bring joy to people. And yeah, online would save you money and time and material and reduce global warming and make sure I don't have like massive 12-foot wings in my bedroom for the rest of eternity and all this stuff, but you'll miss all like the experience of doing this. Being in character brings you so much. It will maybe teach you new things about yourself and help you realize new things about who you are and your personality and who you will be. So I think it would help climate change and stuff, but also at the same time, it takes a lot away from the experience.
Great answer. Maybe that then answers the second one. I mean, you've touched on the personal benefits of designing and creating costumes, wearing costumes. Are there societal benefits, benefits that stretch beyond the individual to all people?
I would say a lot of cultures have traditional costumes and traditional dress, and that change in from normal outfits to something that's different and maybe new is something that's been ingrained in society for a long time, since the 6th century BCE, for example. So I think there is, but I don't really know them off the top of my head because I didn't do research really. I just made stuff. So
no problem.
If there are, I'm not super aware of them.
Well done.
All right.
May I? My turn?
Please.
Oh, no. Mom.
I can't tell if I'll talk with you. I know.
You need the tissue back?
I have a couple of questions. I wanted to know, at the very beginning, you were talking about these five costumes that you wanted to make. One of them actually hammering and building armor, blacksmithing armor in our backyard.
If you don't know this about me, I'm a nerd. So, in my defense,
Do you think you would have had the time to have accomplished all these costumes? Or do you have regrets about not trying something different or?
Firstly, with my procrastination skills, I don't think I would have had the time. I finished these Tuesday night. So, yay, procrastination! But I definitely want to try building armor next. So, look out for that! I will set up a forge, and I'm gonna make a helmet. That's what I want. Yeah.
And then out of all the things that you learned, one of the slides that you had showed geometry and budgeting, not just time, but money, and physics and all those things. What was your favorite thing to learn, and what was the most challenging thing?
Favorite thing to learn was probably how to sew, because that's crucial to making costumes. And now I can go out and like spend all my summer budget from my job on more fabric and make things. And I don't know, skip high school and just make stuff. No, I'm not gonna do that. I'll skip math, but no. Most challenging. Fixing a sewing machine after you've broken it. Finding the end of the needle in a haystack of glitter and tulle. Learning that thimbles are a thing so you don't stab your fingers out a million times. Yeah.
So,
Miss
Florendo would like to show you some of the drawings that she's done just in the beginning. You can come up and look at them afterwards too.
Yeah, so this is the first drawing I did of Ketchum. Back when he had short hair, and this was with his first wife and his son before Dracula went all murder hobo.
Also,
it's a D&D term. It's okay. This is the second drawing I did with his girlfriend, his grown up son, and him when he has long hair after he was turned back into human. This is him on his wedding day with his girlfriend turned wife after his original wife was killed. There's a lot of backstory stuff, I'm sorry. And then this is a little thing I did, which is a quote from Maya Angelou, which is, "You may shoot me with your words, you may cut me with your eyes, you may kill me with your hatefulness, but still like air, I rise."
Figuring out how to make those wings rise. You did a project, an electricity project, that was not quite as advanced as that. So tell me about that just really quickly.
Well, it was mostly convincing my dad to help me. Because, so we, like I said, we basically just, we put the linear actuators on and then we wired it all to the switch. We ended up having to cut a bunch of the wires and add a fuse so I don't explode into flames every time they go up and down. Safety first, kids! It's more advanced than my egg beater, yes. But it was mostly my dad who figured it out, so I can't really explain to you how the electrics work. Hi, Noam.
Hello. Would you consider using this in a D&D roleplay session?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
I'm going to take this to the forest and run around in it until I trip and fall on my face.
All right. Are you going to wear it around Halloween?
Probably. You might see me in the loop in October with massive wings and standing still so I don't fall over.
You did a great job on your presentation. Question: if you were to do this again, except you would, you had like an option to either like choose like shoes or like pants or clothing or like helmet or like a like wings or like other accessories, which one would you want to like do more?
Well, it's been my dream since a little kid to fly, so probably still wings, but I don't know.
Hi, great job, Florendo. I was wondering, what are your other costume ideas? Because I feel like...
Oh, don't get me started, Kate. Okay, so, I've come up with this new D&D character, and... their name is Gemini. They're a human monk with sort of a split personality, so they have two different selves.
and they wear a lot of like billowy robes and like bright colors with patterns on them, and I really want to make that next so I can wear it to high school and feel cool while looking like a nerd, which is a good thing. But yeah. Oh dear.
Marvelous presentation, Miss Florendo. I believe the original idea for your project was cosplay, and it still says that on some of the
You guys make fun of me for it, yes.
So I was just wondering, what was the process of sort of changing your topic?
Well, originally with cosplay, it was get as many costumes as I could done before the end of the school year, so I have all this fun stuff to wear over the summer, and then realizing I don't know how to make these. So my original costume of one costume a month was basically out the window. It's like, I need to learn how to make stuff. So that's kind of when it morphed into costume design and making this and the dress and the wings, which, yeah.
Wonderful presentation, Your Majesty, Florendo. What was your absolute favorite thing to make?
I hated working on the sleeves. That I'm just gonna say that now. The sleeves took like a month and a half because we kept having to fix them and they weren't working. But my favorite thing, I really loved making the dress. Even though I got glitter absolutely everywhere in my dad's office, we still have glitter in the floorboards, I am not kidding you. But it just having like a dress that is just like me and bringing like floaty, swirly, twirly garden dresses back. That was probably my favorite. I also really liked working on the wings, although that was more of a, I have to do this before Masterworks, so I'm just gonna finish it sort of thing. Hi, Jenna.
Hi, I really loved your project. I was wondering, you said that you had to, like, you got the pattern for it, and then you had altered it so much it was almost a different pattern.
Ah, yes.
How did you make it fit you? Because if I did that, I would have to try like 6 times.
We tried probably around 20, so don't worry about it. So the costume I printed off is here. These are a few parts of it. This is the back and the front of my final costume. As you can see, there's scribbles and added bits and all sorts of stuff. So turns out, me being small doesn't fit men's sizing, so we basically had to shrink it down a lot, and then we edited armholes because the armholes were weird, and then we made the custom sleeve design. There was just a lot of editing it, so yeah, I don't know. I'm sorry. Hi, Jua.
Hi. Well done, Ms. Florendo. Beautiful presentation. Love the dress and love the wings and everything. Where did you get the fabric?
Roku's Saris and Fabrics is where I got like the glitter tulle and this like red brocade. Liz brought back, okay, so the backs of the wings, this. Liz brought back the backings for the feathers from LA, like the crushed velvet and like the shimmery black stuff. It's called. So there's a variety of sewing stores. I highly recommend Roku's because their fabric is pretty cheap, good quality. You can also buy pre-made products. So they have like dresses and stuff. It's a lot of fun. I kind of stocked up on fun clothing at the same time as getting fabric. So yeah. There's a reason I'm broke, people. It's not.
Good job. That was really cool. If you were to sell the costume, how much would you sell it for?
Well, taking into account, like, so there was the $500 for the costumes, and then with the feather cost and stuff, time. I would say maybe
$1 million.
Maybe somewhere from 700 to 1,000, depending on who wants it. What?
Double that, at least double that.
Isn't that too much?
No, it's not.
Okay, so maybe 1,000, I don't know. That's
$1 million.
$1 million! maybe 1,500. I don't want to charge too much of it, because even now I'm scared it's going to like fall over and rip. Hi, Cole.
Hello,
Mr. Witty, into the Horizon Productions.
Mine's more of a comment, but working with you through your Masterworks and taking lunch hours to go shoot photos of
your
costumes and getting like to see them kind of before everyone else, it was so much fun to work with you, and I would just like to say thank you for letting me help on your journey through your Masterworks.
Thank you, Cole. That means a lot. Hi, Mandy.
First of all, like, your costumes are amazing. Like, I couldn't do that if I had all the time in the world and, like, a lot of help.
Well, I did have a lot of help, so who knows?
Also, I was curious if you'd ever consider, like, making your own patterns and selling just those patterns, not necessarily the whole costume, but, like, because you talked about how you custom made and you, like, know how to alter patterns and stuff. Would you ever consider doing that and, like, putting them up online for people to use?
So, my biggest fear is judgment, and I've been told a couple times I have a very, like, eccentric clothing style, so I don't know if I'd have the self-confidence to do that, but maybe in time, if more people like my work, then yeah, who knows?
My second thing is, I was curious where you got, like, the inspiration for your characters.
Right there. This is my friend Claire. She's been my inspiration and fuels my creativity. So, also, I highly recommend something called D&D. It's an RPG, and I could go on for hours about this, but yeah. D&D, having an imagination, creating stories, creating characters, creative writing, and just doodling a lot.
Phenomenal presentation, Ms. Florendo. If you were to do this project again, would you, and if you could choose from more money / resources / fabrics or more time, which one would you pick?
I pick mountains of fabric. Because then I could make anything I wanted.
What was your character's name again?
Ketchin Vuvexa.
Ketchin Vuvexa, incredible presentation. You mentioned that your next project was going to be like making some kind of metal armor, and I was wondering when you think you're going to get to that, if ever. Or like, what are your plans with that?
So over the summer, I'm working mornings, which means I have afternoons and evenings to go spend my hard-earned money and buy materials. So I'm hoping over the summer I can do another dress, which is gonna be based off like old parchment and books, because books, yes, love them. And then I really want to make I wanna make armor. It's either going to be leather armor or metal armor. I have a fear of fire as well, so I don't know how that would go, but it's really, I don't know, I need to find something new to inspire me.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
Great job, Ms. Florendo. Wonderful way to end the Masterworks this year. I'm just wondering, you said this was his wedding day outfit. What would a normal day-to-day outfit look like for you?
Well, I must say, it's really the fabric that's from his wedding suit. His wedding suit, So his normal doubleto is made of like the checkered fabric, and it doesn't have such long tails. They're shorter in the back, and it has a like cape to it. His wedding suit, as you can see here, has the longer pointed tails and the gold and red designs on it. So probably there's less gold on it. It's more red. The sleeves aren't as poofy. The tails aren't as long. It would be easier to make.